session of the last day of the Claro Considered Academic Conference here at Red Rocks. We've been having a great time at this conference. Thanks to the audience for showing up today. If you enjoy what you hear here, it will all be archived at the Claro website, which is the Red Rocks website /CLARO. And you can also read all the papers and see all the videos and listen to the podcasts and all of the academic material that will be there for your listening, viewing, watching pleasure later on. Today's panel is something that came out of a collaboration between Claro and one of the history classes here at Red Rocks. And so I'm going to let the historian herself, the professor herself, introduce this panel. Because I totally gave her advance warning I was going to make her do that.
Thanks for that. The project that we developed for this was called A Picture is Worth a Thousand Words, and it's the fact that a story can be told in more ways than one. So what I had was each student pick a simple picture, kind of an iconic picture out of the 20th century, and then write an essay placing themselves in the picture. And what I got was several fantastic points of view and students that were incredibly creative and thought outside the box in ways that I never anticipated when I started this project. So congratulations to you two, and I am looking forward to seeing what you came up with.
All right.
12 seconds. Time it takes for you to start wondering if I forgot what I was going to say. 12 seconds. The time it takes for me to tie my shoes. 12 seconds. It's just the blink of an eye. But on December 17th, 1903, 12 seconds.
Revolutionized the way we travel. Any school child can tell you the names of the Wright brothers, Orville and Wilbur. And they can tell you that they were the first to fly. Yet, as I researched the life of Orville Wright, I realized how little I actually knew about the events leading up to that first flight at Kitty Hawk. I was especially intrigued by the various instances of adversity which the Wright brothers overcame. Wilbur was born in 1867 near Melville, Indiana. Orville was born 4 years later in 1871 in Dayton, Ohio. As children, the Wright brothers were encouraged to pursue their interests in anything that they had interest in. Their enthusiasm for flight was kindled when their father brought home a helicopter, or something like that. That's French for helicopter. They quickly dubbed their toy the Bat, and it probably looked similar to this diagram here. It used two rubber bands to power two propellers to lift the trinket into the air. They started their journey as entrepreneurs when they were just children. One of their first endeavors was kite making. They built, sold, and flew kites with their friends. No doubt, the experiences they had with kites made them want to soar on top of them themselves. As young adults, the Wright brothers started a bicycle company called the Wright Cycle Company. The technical knowledge that they gained from repairing and building bicycles was crucial to their successes later on. On the other side of the Atlantic, a man by the name of Otto Lilienthal was attempting flight. This man was an aeronautics pioneer, and when the Wright brothers heard of his death, their interest in flight actually grew. They wrote to the Smithsonian asking for literature on the subject of flight, and they started watching birds and seeing how they flew. They realized that birds twist their wings to maintain stability and control in the air. They themselves decided to build a kite to see if they could emulate that warping motion that they saw in the birds. Now, at this point, the brothers were about 30. Not exactly your typical flight kiting age. It's rumored that they took kids along when they went to go test their kites so that they didn't get ridiculed by the townsfolk. The Wright brothers then set out to create a full-sized glider. Unfortunately, because of the dense population of cows, lack of wind, and lots of people that would laugh at them, Dayton was not exactly the prime location for testing a glider. But with its high winds, soft sand dunes, and few people, Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, proved to be the prime location for these tests. They set out for Kitty Hawk in September of 1900. Wind conditions, however, were unfavorable for much of the month they were at Kitty Hawk. For much of the time, they had to content themselves with flying their glider like a kite, as they are in this picture. You can see the strings right there. Despite the adverse winds, they were able to make a few glides from the top of Kill Devil Hill, a hill near Kitty Hawk. During these glides, the Wright brothers proved that balanced flight was possible. They returned in July of 1901 with an even larger glider. It had a wingspan of 22 feet. Okay, maybe not so large. The results, however, of their tests were mediocre at best, almost deadly at worst. Even though the curvature of their wings were exactly to Lilienthal's calculations, they did not have satisfactory control over their aircraft, over their glider, excuse me. On one flight, the glider suddenly rose 30 feet and lost forward momentum. However, instead of crashing to the ground, as was the case with Lilienthal's glider, which led to his death, the Wright brothers' glider made a safe, gentle descent. To add to their dismay, the mosquitoes at Kitty Hawk that year were terrible. The heat was intense, and one of their mentors, whom they had invited to come observe their experiments, had brought along an unwelcome visitor who was a burden to them because he was lazy and he wasted a whole bunch of their time. In this photo, Wilbur has just landed after one of their glides. You can see the skid marks right behind the glider there. They left Kitty Hawk that year very depressed. They were ready to give up their dream of flight. Even Wilbur, the most visionary of the two brothers, said that he believed no one would fly for another 1,000 years. He was obviously wrong. A friend sensed their dismay and encouraged them that they had already achieved a whole bunch with their experiments so far. He helped them overcome their despair by inviting Wilbur to speak at a conference for civil engineers. As the Wright brothers prepared for their speech, their enthusiasm was revived. They built a wind tunnel and tested out different wing shapes to determine which gave the most lift. They realized that Lilienthal's calculations were incorrect. With their new findings, they were able to contest the data of previous aeronautics pioneers and show that they were wrong. Virtually overnight, the Wright brothers became the leading figures in the field of aeronautics. The glider they built for the fall of 1902 was the largest yet. It was much more successful than the previous two as well. They were consistently making glides of about 200 feet. Still, they had trouble controlling their craft until, and in one instance, Orville lost control at an altitude of 30 feet and crashed into a sand dune. Orville, luckily, was unscathed, but the glider was a wreck. Persistent as always, the Wright brothers sought ways to improve their glider. Removing one of the tail fins helped, but they still did not have satisfactory control over their craft. One night, as Orville lay awake due to too much coffee, some things just don't change very much. He realized that they needed to have the tail fin move in conjunction with the twisting wings to have the maximum control. Once this change was made, the Wright brothers finally had a practical, controllable glider. In this picture, Orville is performing a simple turn, a maneuver that was previously not possible. On their longest flight that year, Wilbur went 622 and a half feet in 26 seconds. They arrived home in Dayton jubilant and immediately set about creating a motorized glider, an airplane. Not only would this be larger than their glider, it would be powered by a motor. Their first challenge was to fashion a propeller to give them thrust for their airplane. No one, not even the people who built propellers for boats, knew exactly how to make one for the air. So they had to depend on their own calculations to fashion one. They also had to create their own motor because nobody would make one for them. And they had to make sure that it would be light enough that it didn't hinder the craft and not, that it would not hinder the craft from getting off the ground. They came back to Kitty Hawk in September of 1903 with a motorized glider. They called their craft the Flyer. Unfortunately, troubles with the propeller shafts delayed them until December 14th. On that day, Wilbur tried out the aircraft, but the test was unsuccessful. 3 days later, on December 17th, 1903, Orville became the first human to fly. This pivotal moment in human history was captured on film by John Daniels. Although only a crewman at the life-saving station there at Kitty Hawk, Daniels had just taken the most iconic photograph, aviation photograph, ever taken. Orville's flight that day lasted only 12 seconds and took him only 120 feet before landing in the sand. To give you an idea of the insignificance of this distance, it is less than the 140-foot wingspan of the B-29 Superfortress, the plane that would drop the bomb on Nagasaki only 42 years later. Small in length though it was, this event marked the first time in human history that a man-made, heavier-than-air machine had lifted itself by its own power, flew forward, and landed at a spot as high as the place from which it had begun. The Wright brothers made three more flights that day, the longest of which reached 854 feet in 59 seconds. Unfortunately, while they were repairing the Flyer to try another flight, a strong gust of wind blew it over. The Flyer would never soar again. The Wright brothers would make many more planes in the years to come, and their knowledge of aerodynamics is still used to this day. Between the years 1900 and that first flight, the Wright brothers overcame many difficulties, from lack of control over their gliders to mechanical troubles, from depression to wrecked craft. Through it all, the Wright brothers never gave up, always pursuing their dream of flight. The Wright brothers' achievement on that fateful day, December 17th, 1903, would revolutionize the way we travel. On that day, the Wright brothers ushered in a new era in which distances no longer separate peoples and where oceans and borders are no longer barriers to exploration. Thank you.
So we'll save Q&A until the end, and we'll let Zach give us, and you gave him a great segue, by the way, with the wingspan of the craft you'll be indirectly talking about, I think, right?
So then, what he's been describing was the power of flight, and what that made possible 42 years later, I think, that number may just be stuck in my head, but it's something like 40 years later that the atomic bomb was dropped on Japan. That was not the intended segue I had, but let's go from this amazing technological achievement way back in time to, I don't know, something beyond the agricultural age when humans were just kind of starting out. They were just trying to find some ways to make themselves more powerful, some way to make themselves more influential on their surroundings. Because we've always been searching for power, right? Better sources of power, more efficient uses of power, more better ways to get what we want. War, though, is a particularly applicable example because military technology is one of the easiest examples of power searches because of the particular shock of the results of efficient weapons, like the bows and arrows that could kill at greater distances than swords. Guns could kill with less effort than bows and arrows. Bombs, however, were the biggest bang for their buck, if you'll excuse the pun. Although they required more precise support than other types of weaponry, bombs and other explosives were the most efficient ways to kill on a battlefield. The first bombs were used in China in the 13th century. They were just little iron balls basically hollowed out with a bit of gunpowder in them. But they'd make a pretty good bang, and they'd scorch vegetation for, I think they said, about a third of a square kilometer. So it was a decent range, but still kind of starting out. Then we had the power of flight, and we could get bombs directly over targets, bigger payloads, and bigger explosions with more precise delivery. Now, the first bombs dropped by airplane were used by World War I, or I should say, not by airplane, but by aircraft, by the German Zeppelin bombers in their raids over London. Now, this was the first example of something like this, like a bomb being used for this type of shock and awe effect on civilians to try and break the back of the spirit behind the war effort. That was just kind of a little preview in World War I of what was going to happen in World War II. Because in World War II, everyone went pretty much crazy with all of their shock and awe tactics. One of the poster childs of this tactic is the firebombing of Dresden, which I believe killed approximately 23,000 to 25,000 people in the firestorms and destroyed over 6.5 square kilometers of the city center. This happened over 4 days, I believe. The atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki happened in but an instant, but they lasted far longer than that. The first of the bombs was nicknamed Little Boy by the people that developed it and was dropped on the Japanese city of Hiroshima first. This is his story. If I can ever get the pages open. Oh. On August 6th, in the 1945th year of a certain calendar, a nuclear bomb nicknamed Little Boy was dropped on the city of Hiroshima on the island nation of Japan. Little Boy knew nothing of the world, of the war that had been raging for the past 6 years, or anything at all of the surrender in Europe. Little Boy was born and raised in a small lab in Los Alamos in the state of New Mexico in the United States. Little Boy's father was named Julius Oppenheimer, but Little Boy never really knew any of his mothers. He had a lot of them, always coming and going from the lab. On Little Boy's first birthday, when he was just turning 1 month old, his father gave him away to some men who put him alone in a dark room that seemed to move, rattling and shaking. Then the floor opened up beneath Little Boy, and he found himself floating through the sky alone. This is what little boy thought as he fell. Ah, what's happening? He thought. I'm so high. Why am I so high up? It's so cold. I'm falling. Oh no, what is that I'm falling toward? And what is that big thing on the edge of the world over there? It looks like the whole world's on fire. That's not good. It looks like it's coming for me. I can see the land, though. It's so very far away. I hope I can reach it before that big ball of fire on the edge of the world catches me. I don't want to burn. Help me, land. Something's holding me back, though. What is it? I can't twist around to see it. It's holding me awful tight now, isn't it? It should go away. I need to get down from here. Wait, what is that on the ground? There are a lot of little things moving around on it. Are those people? Sure, awful lot of them, aren't there? Lots of big metal things in the... Well, I guess I'd better start finding names for these things, so I'll call it a harbor. And those big metal things I shall call ships. I wonder if they'll be friends with me. Hello, ships. And in that moment, something so vastly, hugely, mind-bogglingly improbable happened that the entire world shook because of it. Little boy turned into a cloud. He was a very impressive cloud, to be sure. He was tall, he was wide, but curiously enough, he was shaped like a giant mushroom. Little boy towered into the skies and stretched completely over the ground, suddenly not so little anymore. Ooh. His senses tingled, and he could suddenly feel within him the energy of 255,000 souls burning in an instant in the city below him. As little boy raced along the ground, he ran up to each person in the city as fast as he could, eager to meet them and become friends with them. All of the people in the city, though, looked up at him and ran. It seemed as though they wanted to play tag with little boy, so little boy played along. He ran after all of them, not wanting to leave anyone out of the games. But something strange happened as he did. They all died when little boy touched them. Little boy ran for miles around with an enthusiasm that melted roof tiles 600 meters away and granite stone nearly 1,000 meters away as he tried to find someone that would play with him. But he watched each person he tagged melt away before him. With each person, little boy felt his enthusiasm start to melt away just as they did. When little boy grew tired from all the running he'd done in the city of Hiroshima, he looked back at the city. His whole playground had flattened, melted, and burned in an enormous circle. Behind little boy lay a carousel of destruction and death. A high keening sound filled the air as little boy's heart broke at the sight, and he faded into the mist. Little boy, now not as little boy as he once was, faded into a mist finer than atoms. He became everything radioactive, and his awareness spread into the entire ruined city of Hiroshima. Little boy's spirit wandered through the ruins with nothing to do, wanting to help. But his touch could only bring more death, so he withheld himself and just watched. He watched across the countryside that only a few hours ago he had been happily frolicking in as people he had never tagged continued to die in pools of vomit and blood on the ground. Everyone was covered in terrible burns that looked as though they would never heal. Little boy cried then, his spirit broken. And his tears were the black rain that fell upon the city that day. The little boy cried for 2 hours while his grief for the city flooded. His tears were sickly things, sticky, demonically black, and full of the radioactivity that was little boy's essence. His tears swelled the banks of the rivers, lakes, and streams of the small country. They traveled far through the country, bringing the sickness of little boy's grief. Ooh. Little boy watched with reddened eyes as people flooded in from all over the country, calling out for their mothers, or their fathers, or their sisters or brothers, or simply helping out wherever they could to climb out of the rubble that their lives had been reduced to. He watched then as those people too succumbed to his spirit, wasting away before acute sicknesses. Little boy saw people lose control of their digestive systems. He saw the very blood flowing in their veins rebel and struggle to break free of its flesh. And he watched helplessly as burns from his fiery debut worsened everything. Until the end of 1945, little boy stayed in the city of Hiroshima, watching everything and wishing he hadn't had to grow up so fast. Little boy, in those 5 months he spent wandering, saw over 140,000 people die, unable to coexist with an environment in which he resided. Little boy watched with horror as his younger brother, nicknamed Fat Man, was unleashed on the city of Nagasaki, 300 kilometers away, on August 9th. He watched with apathy as the war ended aboard a ship in his harbor a month later. That was when little boy, who was not so little anymore, decided to give up. Everything he touched turned to ash and dust, and everyone he saw wasted away, their own bodies rebelling against them. He faded away into the hills, wanting so very badly to disappear entirely. The ground of the area, though, had its own ideas and held fast to little boy, keeping him prisoner in Hiroshima. The people of this city, disfigured and scarred in their minds and bodies, continued to die, less and less of acute diseases and more of a disease where their very cells rebelled against them. A disease little boy later learned was called cancer. And there little boy weeps to this day. Well, as you said, yeah, the name Little Boy did come from the Maltese Falcon, and while I've never read the book or seen the movie, I know that Little Boy, Fat Man, and I think there was a third nickname for an unexploded project, Thin Man, that also came from the Maltese Falcon. I don't really know. I imagine the researchers working on the bomb thought it was ironic. I mean, German soldiers in World War II nicknamed the mouse heavy tank the same way. It was a giant 200-ton tank, and then nicknamed it after a mouse.